The federal government today confirmed that a Russian criminal group is behind the hacking of a crucial energy pipeline. The Biden administration said it is working with the Colonial Pipeline Company to deal with the cyber hack and its effects. Colonial shut down its pipeline, the largest of its kind in the U.S., after the company learned it was the victim of this cyber extortion attempt. William Brangham is back now with the latest on that story.
Judy, the FBI said a group known as DarkSide is responsible for this cyber attack, which used what is known as ransomware. Ransomware is malicious computer code that blocks an owner's access to their computer network until a ransom gets paid. Colonial operates a 5,500-mile-long pipeline that carries almost half the jet fuel and gasoline that's delivered along the East Coast. The company has so far refused to say whether it paid any ransom, but said it hopes to be largely back online by the end of this week. So far, the impact on gas prices has been small. But this attack is just the latest example of ransomware incidents in the U.S. By one estimate, in just the past year, more than 113 federal, state, and municipal agencies, 500-plus health facilities, and more than 1,600 schools, colleges, and universities have all been attacked with ransomware. For more on this and the justifiable alarm bells it's ringing, I'm joined by Megan Stifel. She's with the Global Cyber Alliance, which is a nonprofit dedicated to reducing cyber risk. Very good to have you on the NewsHour. This most recent attack on this pipeline, I think largely because it's such a major piece of infrastructure, seems like a real escalation. Is this among the worst type of ransomware attack we've seen so far?
Thanks very much for having me tonight. In terms of its household recognition of this being an important issue, I would say yes. But we've seen in the past, for example, WannaCry that happened in 2017 hit victims in 150 countries. So this is a major incident in terms of the impact it can have on the East Coast and infrastructure distribution, but sadly more could come and has in the past.
So as I mentioned, ransomware is basically holding a computer network hostage for money. And the company behind the hackers behind this said, yes, that was their goal. But does ransomware software allow hackers to do more than just hold the system? Could they sabotage it? Could they use it for nefarious purposes? Does it allow you to do that?
In some cases, yes. When an actor gains access to a network such as this, they could have the ability to have very serious consequences on safety. But it also is against their interests to do so. If an individual or if there's harm done, significant impact, that in some ways can ruin their brand, so to speak. And in this case, and other networks, they say, oh, we're not going to target healthcare sector. I think we're seeing that these folks probably didn't mean to have the impact in this instance that they did.
So I touched on these huge numbers, but is this a growing epidemic? Are we seeing a rise in these types of attacks?
Yes, particularly over the past year. You mentioned some figures that to me, I think, add up to this one that we know well, which is 2,400 school systems, government, and healthcare facilities in 2020 were reportedly the victims of ransomware. And that's only the reported victims. The issue, too, that we see in this space is that not all victims want to come forward to law enforcement. And that really hinders the ability for law enforcement and the government to make an informed decision and develop the best policy options that they have to try and counter this attack.
So from a technical perspective, how does ransomware get into a computer network?
Technically, in most cases, ransomware evolves from a suspicious email. Someone clicks on an email that we call these phishing emails, where someone who you think is an associate or a colleague sends you an email saying, I need you to open this, I need you to do this right now, luring you into clicking on a link. That link often reroutes the user to not the intended place they thought they were going, but to a malicious website that then is involved in downloading further malicious software, allowing the perpetrators to gain access to that particular individual's computer and thereby the organization's network. And depending on how well the network is architected, they may have access then to a range of places within the network, to very sensitive data, to in some cases not so sensitive data. But in most cases, these types of actors will look for data that they know is valuable and that they can then, again, hold it ransom so that they can make money.
It's amazing how simple it is that one click on a dubious email can set off this chain reaction and really imperil huge pieces of infrastructure.
It is, and we don't want to overplay the simplicity of it, right? There are a number of steps that can be taken that can frustrate these actors' ability to have such an outsized impact. known best practices, such as using multi-factor authentication on networks, making sure that there are automatic backups to data, making sure that software is as kept up as up to date as possible, so that vulnerabilities, which is how these exploits these types of activities are able to take advantage of a weakness in the network, making sure that those vulnerabilities are closed. So it takes a range of steps, and in some cases they have to be lucky once, and in some cases they may have to spend additional time on a victim's network. And the goal here is to make sure that everyone's using best practices so that it's not their network that's at risk, it's someone else's.
It seems like you're describing quite a few different holes to patch, both our personal behavior, the way we build software, and then how companies operate this software. Do you think that there's a role for the government to play in any of this in helping these best practices move along?
Absolutely. I was fortunate to lead a ransomware task force that actually convened wrapped up our concluding remarks just 2 weeks ago. And that group came together, over 50 organizations, and identified a range of actions that could be taken, some involving the government. In particular, in this instance, we recommended that the government, our government, as well as a number of international partners and allies, work together and determine and make public that ransomware is an international national security risk, and therefore that they needed to also develop a coalition of governments working to enforce the laws and to bring these perpetrators to justice. But also, in addition to undertaking investigative measures, we've seen ransomware as the latest symptom of a range of cybersecurity vulnerabilities and weaknesses, as you mentioned. And we therefore think that there needs to be additional incentives, and potentially there may need to be the need for regulation, particularly of components of critical infrastructure, such as was a victim today. And that will be hopefully the subject of public debate.
I mean, the Biden administration today pointed the finger at this particular hacking group, DarkSide, but also hinted that they might be based in Russia and that the Russian government might have some responsibility in all this. Do you have a sense of, I mean, let's just say other governments are involved. That's a much trickier nut if you have to try to get other governments to crack down on actors within their own borders.
It is. Unfortunately, we know in many cases in ransomware that the actors are operating from something we call safe havens, governments who are unwilling or otherwise unable to help further an investigation of this type. And in that case, we have to work with other governments and the private sector to use additional measures to try and bring these perpetrators to justice. That could involve a range of actions, including, as we've already seen from this administration, additional sanctions on Russia, as well as looking at other measures such as foreign and military aid were recommendations from this task force that I was involved in, really looking at all elements of national power to try and bring additional importance and really make an impact on this growing threat.
All right. Megan Stifel of the Global Cyber Alliance, thank you very much for being here.
Thanks very much for having me.